92.1 WROI, WROIFM.com. We are streaming audio live on RTC Channel 5, and we'll soon have audio and video on RTC Channel 4. Hey, Elizabeth, welcome back.
Hello.
You got your own coffee cup in the studio yet?
No, I need one.
Okay, we'll have to do that for you. No problem. Anyway, on this Monday, we're going to have our Doc Talk radio program, and Dr. Eric Seward joins us in the studio. Good morning.
Hey, good morning.
Thank you for being here.
Happy Earth Day, I believe, right?
I believe it is Earth Day, yes.
Yeah,
happy Easter yesterday, happy Earth Day today.
It was happy 420 day the day before that.
That's
Friday
exactly
before
right.
That. This is the holiday season, right?
We're rolling now.
I don't know what that even means.
I don't either, but we're rolling through it, no doubt about it.
Yeah.
We have a topic today that is near and dear to practically everyone. And so I want to remind our listeners, if they have a question as we go through the course of the program, give us a call at 223-6059.
Yeah, I'm even going to throw out suggestions to give us topics, because one of the things I always try to balance, I'm an OBGYN doctor, so right. I deliver babies and take care of women's health problems for the most part. I have a sort of a generic interest in wellness and exercise and some of those things, but I'm always asking around every month, like, what do you want to hear about? What do you want to hear about? What do you want to hear about? And I think it's fun to keep it relevant to a lot of people. But then again, I always throw it out through the prism of the obstetrics gynecologist. I think when I ask my friends, they all want to hear about the titillating sex topics.
And of course.
And I'm okay with that. And every once in a while, somebody says, you should talk about politics. And I'm always a little worried about that, although I'm happy to do it.
At least the kids are in school by now.
Yeah. But this one is neither of those. What I'm going to talk about a little bit today is hypertension, and I am going to put it through the prism of the obstetrician, but I'm going to start by saying that a huge percentage of our population, particularly those who are over the age of 50, are suffering with some version of hypertension. Most of the time, it's what we call essential hypertension. And it has to do with a number of factors. I would encourage everybody to think a little bit about our blood vessels as being the pipes in your house. And, you know, if you just think about the simple sort of pipe system in your house, taking water hither and yon, if the pressure is too high in that system, you are more likely to spring leaks. You're more likely to wear out faucets and wear out your appliances faster. You know, if it's too low, you can't take a good shower. So it has to be maintained in a zone that will, you know, sort of maintain that house. And eventually your house pipes will fall apart. All of us have different kinds of pipes in our house. Most of them are stainless steel. Some of them are made of that plastic Kevlar, right, or whatever that stuff is. And older houses may even have iron-based pipes. And they all have their pros and their cons, but some wear out faster. We're stuck with the pipes that we've got. But that pressure is something that sort of affects every aspect of our health, and some major sort of effects that sometimes affect people's health directly are the almost direct result of high blood pressure, and it's a contributing factor in a lot of things. Now, when a person is 18 or 25 or 30 or even 35, for the most part, their blood vessels are very compliant, meaning they are stretchy. And so when that happens, that generally decreases the blood pressure, and it allows for a little bit more space in the vascular system for sort of the highs and lows. One of the problems that teenagers oftentimes get into, and I've had this happen to me a few times, is you stand up real quick, you get lightheaded, and
exactly,
either nearly hit,
sure,
the deck or do hit the deck. Well, when you're a teenager, that's because the blood pressure drops very low, very fast, because the system is running on a low pressure for the most part. As we get older, the blood vessels slowly harden in time. And almost every 80 or 90-year-old has some rigidity to that system. So now you're pushing blood through these pipes that are harder, less compliant. They don't absorb as much of the pressure, and so that pressure sort of runs up higher.
So it's harder to pump the blood through there at that point in time.
It is. And that's aside from the fact that in some key places, you may even have some narrowing of those arteries because of atherosclerotic plaques. Whole different topic, but it does affect how the system, how those pipes in the system respond. It's just real basic blood pressure 101. When somebody puts a cuff on your arm and they pump up that cuff either electronically or manually, it gets tighter and tighter and tighter.
It does.
I've never had this. And they're pumping it to the point that they are compressing the vein in the arm that they're testing flat. They're trying to make it so that no blood is flowing through that vein. And then they slowly release that pressure. And when you first hear a noise, that's when that vein is first allowing some blood to come through. And when you get down to the lowest noise, and you're listening for that first sound of that pulse as it's first coming through the vein, and then at some point it gets so low that the blood's just flowing freely and you can't hear it anymore, then you kind of lose that sound. And so these are the sort of the high point and the low point in the system. We call that systolic blood pressure and diastolic. A better way, I think, to think about it is the lub-dub of your heart. Every time your heart pushes, it's a pump, you know, it's pumping. When it pumps, the whole blood pressure goes up in the system. When it relaxes, the whole blood pressure drops down, and then it pumps again. And so we're kind of doing this high and low. When it's the high point of that pressure, that's our systolic blood pressure. It's the maximum pressure in the system. The diastolic is the sort of rest pressure, the lowest pressure. And it turns out our hearts beat, and then they relax in sort of a 1-to-2 ratio. So every beat has about one-third of the time in the whole beat cycle, and every relaxation phase drops for about two-thirds of that. So it turns out that lower number actually is probably more important, because what's going to wear down the pipes in your house is going to be the average pressure, not the pressure when you're taking a shower or when everybody in the whole house is taking a shower, not the pressure when it's at its highest point, but what's happening with those pipes all the time. And so we sometimes talk in terms of mean arterial pressure. Mean arterial pressure isn't like really mad bad arterial pressure. It's the average, you know, mean average blood pressure. And it turns out that diastolic has a sort of carries two-thirds of the weight of that mean pressure. So a lot of times when people look at their numbers and they say they get a number that's 150 over 60, well, that low number is pretty low. And so it's gonna keep that average blood pressure pretty low, even though the high number might be a bit high. On the other hand, you can have a pretty normal high number, 135, but if that low number is riding at 100, that's going to drive up that blood pressure on average.
Is there an ideal blood pressure?
There absolutely is. Yeah, we'll get to that. But the typically for adults, we kind of use 140 over 90 as the sort of standard. And there are some guidelines that are out by that most primary care physicians use, and they have to have three separate readings on different occasions, sort of under different circumstances. You could imagine somebody could, you know, walk in off the street having a super stressful day and, you know, just dodged a car and, you know, got a call from their spouse saying that, you know, they didn't pick up their underwear off the floor. And it's one of those days. You walk in, get your blood pressure checked, and it's high. You know, it's going to be high. But then they go to yoga class, and they have a nice lunch and take a nap, and everything's going great. And they get that call and say, you know, it wasn't your underwear after all; it was mine. And you're a really good guy. And you go back, get your blood pressure checked. It might be perfectly normal. So we tend to accept the fact that there are little variations in our daily blood pressures. So we look for multiple episodes of high blood pressure over time. There are some thresholds that get to be scarier. Certainly when we see somebody that walks in with a diastolic blood pressure over 120, that's starting to get into the scary zone. If that person happens to be a 22-year-old, they can probably handle it for a little while, and that might affect how we approach that. But if that person is 60, they might find themselves admitted to a hospital. The upper number is usually right around 200 when people start to get a little excited about it.
Okay.
But those are sort of the blood pressure numbers and the idea behind what blood pressure is and what we're looking for and sort of why we're looking for it. Now, when we say essential blood pressure, essential hypertension, and hypertension is a fancy word for high blood pressure.
Okay.
Essential hypertension just sort of means we don't really have a reason. It's some combination of genetics, age, you know, what you're eating, whatever, you know, life in its whole. We don't have a specific disease or thing that we can say this is causing it. There are some very specific kinds of blood pressure. Occasionally people will have a renal artery or a kidney process that's making the blood pressure go up. That's a sort of a special subset, and it has a very specific cause that if you can fix it, it will help. There's a thing called pulmonary hypertension, slightly different thing, very scary, very dangerous. Pulmonary hypertension is when you have sort of a specific blood pressure elevation in the sort of cardiac to pulmonary backflow. When that happens, it inhibits the way that our heart and lungs function together, getting oxygen out to the system. And that's actually got a much higher mortality rate, especially under some specific circumstances. Interesting little factoid, the medicine Viagra was originally designed to take care of pulmonary hypertension. Turns out it cleared up blood flow in other parts of our body. And those were more popular amongst the general population. Just a little your fun fact for the day. And then in my world, the thing that we deal with all the time is pregnancy-associated or pregnancy-induced hypertension. One version of that we're always concerned with is called preeclampsia. And that's a whole topic unto itself. Right. We'll get into that at some point. But, you know, that's something that's very specific to pregnancy. In very short order, It's a complex combination of issues that probably deal with the paternal aspect of a baby and placenta and how it affects the vasculature. I like to think of it as if you took an organ out of a husband and stuck it into a wife, that wife would reject that husband. It doesn't mean she's mad at him because he left his clothes on the bathroom floor, but it's just the way our bodies work. You have to have very specific proteins, or we recognize things as foreign and we attack it. But she can accept half of a whole different person that came from him, and it's placenta. And there's a whole lot of complex things that have to happen. When they don't happen just perfectly, then it leads to this cascade, which has this very specific version of blood pressure issues. So these are sort of the big topics. Okay. There are some others. That said, there are a number of medications. I'm sure that many of our listeners and many of our friends and colleagues, and in my case, a lot of my patients and family members and everybody else, that are taking blood pressure medicines. And there are some big categories. There's a whole laundry list of them. A lot of people take ACE inhibitors. They take calcium channel blockers. There are diuretics. There are beta blockers. And what those things do, just in short order, calcium channel blockers block calcium just like it sounds, but that changes the way that the musculature works, and it allows for less pressure to be put on the system. There are alpha and beta receptors that are things that are part of the nervous system input. And when you block the beta signals, it loosens up blood pressure in the system. Diuretics are things that make the kidneys get rid of extra fluid. When they get rid of extra fluid, it makes sense. You know, it's, we were talking about leeches earlier, just before we got on the air.
Exactly.
They're not a good treatment. If your doctor gives you leeches for blood pressure, don't do it. But but the idea, I think, is that you kind of get rid of that extra volume in the plasma, and that decreases that overall pressure. In mild cases, that works pretty well. There are a number of different medications, sort of the point. One of the things, and I a lot of times I think we in Western medicine get criticized for just writing prescriptions. You know, you hear a lot about it with our narcotics problems.
Right,
well,
exactly.
Doctors write prescriptions. Somebody comes in, they got a pain here, there, or over there. Write a prescription for something that gets rid of that pain, makes patients feel better, they like us, you know, we like them more. But then it leads on to other issues. And, you know, there's this, lots of discussions about big pharma and the politics of that. It's easy. And I'll tell you that as a doctor, it's easy for me to write a script. It's impossible for me to chase somebody around with a whip and make them not eat that third taco.
Right.
You know, or to get out and exercise. But there are a lot of lifestyle things that affect blood pressure, and they are controllable by people. If you think about what happens in our vasculature, so the plasma and the blood volume that's pulsing through our veins or arteries at any moment, it's filled with what we call electrolytes. You hear a lot about this. Gatorade people would tell you you can't have too many. But you can have too much sodium, and sodium is one of the biggest electrolytes in our system. Sodium, among others, are things that go into the vasculature
and they
suck fluid back into the system. Now, in some cases, that's good. I mean, if you're truly the guy on the Gatorade commercial that's sweating buckets, it's good to replace that sulfur.
Sure.
That you're losing. But it makes sense that from a dietary point of view, you know, you can control that. We eat gobs of salt in our society. We salt everything. I don't know how many times my mom had to tell me to taste something
before
I
put
it.
Salt on it.
And now
exactly.
I find myself saying that to people too, you know.
As well as your own children.
Yeah, and for the most part, almost every processed food, almost everything you get at a restaurant anywhere is got, you know, extra. I mean, you can use up your daily amount of sodium in, you know, half of breakfast.
Sure.
And then the rest of the day is just all stuff you're dumping into the system. And salt is very readily absorbed into the system, and because of that, it kind of immediately impacts things. Really good kidneys will offset that. They'll do that extra work, but in time that becomes a problem. And so diet is one thing that people can do. Being overweight, which a lot of us are, I can't remember the statistic exactly, but for every 10 pounds, I think there's an extra mile of blood vessels that your heart has to pump blood through. And if you,
which is a lot when you think about it.
It is a lot. And if some listener out there wants to fact check me on that, I would be more than happy to accept that that's from a vague memory from med school many, many years ago. But it was something dramatic like that. And basically every extra bit of weight that we're carrying around, we're making our heart work that much harder to pump blood out to the different bits and parts, and that makes our blood try to amp up things in order to get blood to the tippy tip of your fingertips or the outside aspect of our chub or our toes or our brains. It has to work harder to push it through more space. So being overweight makes a big difference. Think about what happens when somebody goes and gets on a treadmill and starts sweating, or goes to Zumba class and starts sweating. They're going to get rid of a lot of salty, saline-y sweat.
Right.
Well, that's one of that's nature's way of getting rid of that extra salt. The minute you do that, your body's going to start to resorb a lot of that sodium in places that it needs to have it set aside for. It's a great way to kind of cleanse out and kind of keep that blood pressure low. Plus, going through that process of aerobic exercise makes the whole cardiovascular system more compliant and more capable. So there are a lot of lifestyle things, and you know, I think these are the harder things for us docs to talk about, because I could write it on a prescription pad, get out there and exercise, you know, don't eat salt. It's hard to do. Anybody that's ever like had a heart attack, gone through that process of trying to create a low sodium diet, knows that it doesn't taste very good. And right. and you got to really kind of be
creative. You hear that a lot.
With, and yeah, I think half of the, you always hear, well, hospital right. food doesn't taste for us because, you know, you're on a cardiac diet. It's like, oh, that's very good. And I think, you know, when you're looking at how you can kind of arrange your life, these are some of the things that are obviously good. To touch base a little bit on my world and preeclampsia, there certainly are medicines that we don't like to use in pregnancy. I mentioned ACE inhibitors. ACE inhibitors have some specific birth defects. There's a classification system for medicines and birth defects that goes A, B, C, D, and they skip to X. I think that's dramatic. But A's, to be an A, you have to have been tested on pregnant women and shown to be safe, period. There aren't many medicines like that because there's a lot of ethical issues with testing medicines on pregnant women. So almost all the information we have about pregnant women comes from just sort of, well, we know these people have been exposed to this, you know, what happened? That's what we call retrospective data, and it's not as good, it's not as mm-hmm. strong. Or we have lots of information from mice and rats and rabbits and guinea pigs. And that might not be very, very specifically the way that we as people respond to a medicine. And usually those are tested in mega doses, and that becomes a little convoluted. So A's have to have been tested. They have to be things that people know or expect are going to be safe before they ever even start that study to get sort of into this thing ethically. B's are things that we pretty sure are safe. So things like A's are Tylenol and Tums. I like to say it's Tylenol and Tums. B's are things that we are pretty sure are safe. And they're things like Benadryl and a lot of the over-the-counter okay. cold medicines, okay. things like that. C's are things that the data is just insufficient. They're right. the newer medicines that might be safe. We think they're safe. We look back at retrospective studies, and they look okay, but maybe there was a guinea pig study with 100 times the normal dose that we're not sure what the actual like relationship mm-hmm. is to the way we would use this as people. So we think they're probably safe, but there's insufficient data. And we can't claim that for sure. We say use those things with cautions. Most medicines that we give, most prescription medicines that we give, and for us these would be beta blockers and calcium channel blockers in pregnancy for the most part, are going to be category C medicines. Category D medicines have known birth defects. This is where our ACE inhibitors come in. They have known birth defects in some cases, and a good example would be seizure medications. Their category D medicines have known birth defects, but sometimes we just have to use them right. because it may be necessary sure. Sure. in the circumstances. Sure. And then category X medicines, or I don't even think about it. You know, the famous one right now is Rogaine, but I think chemotherapies, for the most part, if you think about how they right. work, they work on developing cells, and they are not going to be safe for babies. So we stick with a couple of key categories of medications in pregnancy. It's usually limited. The nice thing about pregnancy is at 9 months, it's over, and most of the time these things slowly resolve thereafter when they're truly pregnancy-induced. In my world, you know, I'm not dealing with a lot of ongoing chronic hypertension. I usually get some of my colleagues at Woodlawn Hospital to hop in and sure. help out with those sure. things when they're ongoing. A lot of hospitals, I think we're small enough that all of our primary care folks are pretty good, but a lot of hospitals where I came from out in New Mexico, they were developing point people at each like major clinic who you would contact if you had a patient that came through, say, an emergency room, or say, I got somebody in my office as a specialist, and I'm like, oh, this needs to be taken care of, and, you know, you get on the horn right away with that clinic, talk to that person, and it's there's a growing understanding. There's always been an understanding that blood pressure plays a role in health, but there's a growing understanding that it's the more tightly you control it and the faster you get it under control, the better that is for people. So it used to be thought that, well, we'll bring it down in time, we'll get it there, we'll a little more laissez-faire, kind of like same thing with diabetes, we'll get right, it there, right, work exactly, on it,
exactly.
We'll accept what we can get. And then the last thing I wanted to touch base on is stuff that that sort of the consequences of having high blood pressure.
Okay.
Certainly, it plays a role in heart disease. It plays a role in vascular disease. One of the things that you think about right offhand would be strokes.
Exactly.
Most of the time, strokes are caused by plaques that build up usually in the arteries that are running up in the neck, the carotid arteries, and then little bits of that chip off in the face of high blood pressure. Just imagine a rock on the side of a river. Mm-hmm. That river is just lazily plodding along. It's probably not going to fall off very quick. If that's a raging river going through a gorge in Colorado, it's going to suck a lot of rocks with it.
Sure.
And those things shoot right up to the brain. They block parts of the brain. They cause a stroke. What part of the brain they block will depend on what the consequences of that are. Blood pressure is very directly related to that.
Any relation to diabetes?
Diabetes causes more hardening of the arteries. It causes more renal disease, and as a result of that, can cause blood pressure issues.
I got it.
So it's sort of a, it's not really a chicken egg argument. It's more of diabetes,
right.
Causes it. Blood pressure in and of itself doesn't cause diabetes, but there is a relationship the other way.
Okay.
So those are and you can have other end organ infarctions that are going to be increased by blood pressure. You can get infarcted kidneys. You can get infarcted other bits of, every once in a while you'll see people that'll get blood clots in the tips of their fingers, things like that. And these can be, they're not always, but they can be the result of blood pressure problems, or they can be sort of manifested more. I think strokes are probably the biggest one that we deal with. And one of the ways to best prevent strokes would be to keep that blood pressure in normal.
Exactly, exactly.
I would encourage everybody out there to know your blood pressure.
Right.
Get it checked often. It changes. It's
daily,
it's,
weekly. Does it?
Oh, I think if you've got access to a blood pressure cuff, either if you work at a place that has a blood pressure cuff, you have one on your own, I think it's good to keep. I think a lot of my patients get a little over obsessive about some things. The people that have a blood pressure cuff at home. My pregnant ladies that have blood pressure cuffs at home are they're constantly calling and say, hey, that high number was 143, and I'm like, okay, all right, calm down, And keep in mind, too, that a lot of the blood pressure cuffs at home may not be, the grade and quality of what we use in a hospital. The other thing that's kind of interesting, blood pressure, when people are active and out running around, probably runs a little higher than it does when you're resting. But there's this thing called white coat hypertension. Now, I don't ever wear a white coat, probably for this very reason, but a lot of doctors do. It's sort of the signature look of the doctor. And the idea is that people come in to see the doctor and their blood pressure runs a little bit higher. I don't know if they're worried about where we're going to poke and prod them, or whether we're going to take blood, or what the deal is. But there's... And that's part of the reason, too, why we want those three separate readings. Sure. A lot of times, if the way it workflows go in most doctor's offices, a patient comes in, they sign in, they register, they get through the paperwork. That probably drives up a little blood pressure. They get brought back, they get put on a scale. That drives up the blood pressure a little bit. And then right after that, I've got my medical assistant checking their blood pressure.
Exactly.
I'm walking in the room, I'm looking, oh, my gosh, this blood pressure's high. A lot of times, the very first thing I'll do is say, hey, tell them a couple of jokes, calm down, see how their kids are doing in school. And then at the end of it, when everybody's calm and they realize I'm not coming after them with needles, before I tell them they've got to go to the lab, I'll have my medical assistant come back in and check blood pressure again.
Dr. Eric Seward is being our guest, and of course he is OBGYN at Woodlawn Hospital, and a lot of good information today on blood pressure.
Good. Well, I'm like I said, I think some of these topics we talk about are general health topics, and I like to hit those probably about every other time I come in. Last time we talked a bit about diabetes, but some of them are going to be specific to my field, and some of them are driven by the interests of the people. I ask every time I'm coming in to talk to you guys, or every time somebody asks me what topic we're going to talk about, I throw it open to the suggestions of the folks around me, and any listeners out there want to add to that, or anybody here
sure.
Got some burning medical question, sure. we can talk about it.
You are at Woodlawn Hospital.
I am. Almost every day.
And we can get a hold of you either by calling or
you can call the hospital. You can, my clinic's right up in, okay. In the Woodlawn. We're WIMPs. We're the Woodlawn Medical Professionals. And I'm right there in the hospital on, I guess that would be the east end of the hospital, right. Second floor. Come in and see me.
Dr. Eric Seward, good information. Thank you.
Hey.